Hey Podders, welcome to episode 85 of CosPod, the podcast for all things cosplay. Welcome to all of our new viewers. I've actually been checking on the international stats lately, and once more, we've had some new countries joining our top 10 list. And I always find it really cool whenever we have, you know, new international viewers watching the show, just because cosplay is such an international hobby. But we don't always think of it that way, just because, you know, not a lot of us venture out to other conventions in other places. So it's so cool. I'm so excited.
We're probably also getting a lot of new viewers today because of AllCon. I wonder why.
Yes, there is that. So why don't we go ahead and jump right into it, since this will effectively be our cosplay updates for this episode.
Right.
As we do our review of AllCon, which we actually just finished yesterday.
Yay!
We're having this the day after. So AllCon is held in Addison, Texas. I believe this was their 11th year.
Ding.
And they have been going strong, like, ever since I've been going, at the very least, at the Crown Plaza there in Addison. They will be moving next year, and you guys will, those of you who receive their postcards will be receiving them in the mail shortly, but they're moving to the Westin near the Galleria in Dallas next year. And they're also changing weekends next year. I believe they will be the 17th through the 20th of March, instead of being the second weekend like they have been for the last few years. So keep that in mind if you guys are already planning on next year, as I know a lot of you do. Let's start with Friday, since that was the first day that we attended. Unfortunately, we weren't able to be there Wednesday, Thursday due to day jobs.
Work. It's a thing.
Yes. So were you there early Friday?
I had to be, otherwise we wouldn't have had so many contestants in our cosplay contest.
So go ahead and, you know, extol your Friday, since I didn't get there until right before the contest.
Not a problem. So we had lots of fun times on Friday, since Amber had to do her overnight gig, which was totally cool. I ended up having to solo for pretty much most of the day and try to get some last-minute sign-ups. With AllCon, they don't do a whole lot of pre-regging in the past with their cosplay contest. Oh, by the way, Amber and I were in charge of their cosplay contest, if you didn't already know that from the, like, 20 times that we promoted it on our show in the past year. Just saying. Anyway, so I wanted to make sure that we did a lot of on-site reg on Friday in particular, because I knew that's when most people would be showing up and checking in, and I was in that hallway working my little butt off to try to get more people to sign up. Every single person I saw walking by, I was like, hey, cosplay contest, we're giving away all this cool stuff, please come sign up. And with that, we had 8 pre-regs, and then we had an ungodly amount more show up, so we had 23 official people sign up. So that was really cool. And of those 23, only 3 dropped out last minute because of, you know, sickness or costume malfunctions or whatever the case may be. So we had a good solid 20 people, which is more than the past 3 years of contestants combined. It was epicness. Yay. I'm just proud of my selling skills, because usually I'm not really good at, like, selling things. And I was working my butt off. I even made a sign. I made a sign. Do I have my sign around here somewhere, or did I stick it back in my closet? I think I tucked it away, because it was a very cheesy sign. There's images of it on our Facebook page. I made it very last minute. But it worked. I got enough attention that people started flocking to our table and started signing up. It was very awesome. I was really happy. And it just means, I think, with the number of people we had this year, if we're asked to come back and do this again next year, maybe more people will sign up. That'll be great.
And I believe we clocked in at just over an hour. We started very much on time.
Oh, yeah.
And we went. I mean, there were no mishaps, no breaks. I mean, aside from, obviously, the planned breaks. But everything went about as well as we possibly could have asked it to, as people who are running a cosplay contest for the first time.
Yeah, exactly. Especially with us having a really tiny budget, small crew to do all this with. I mean, it was basically Amber's laptop providing all the music and all the videos. Yeah, and I had basically a sheet of paper that said, okay, who's going in what direction, and go! Yeah. We did well for the two of us and our lovely, wonderful assistants.
The audience was standing room only by the end. I mean, there were literally people standing along the back wall.
Great.
Which was really awesome.
I'm so glad to see that.
Very much. We had several people walk up to us after the show who complimented us on how the cosplay contest was run. And we had several more people the next day come up to us and also mention about the cosplay contest, which was actually rather flattering.
That was nice.
Nothing gives you an ego boost like people saying, "You've done good, guys. You've done good."
Exactly. And it wasn't like we rushed any of the contestants through it or anything. I mean, we made sure that everybody had ample amount of time on the stage. It was a minimum of 30 seconds, and everyone really utilized their time. So it didn't feel rushed, but it was over in an hour, and everybody was like, "Oh, cool, I can just go about my business and go back to the con." That was kind of nice.
Yeah. And of course, we've already thanked all of our helpers on our blog publicly at the contest and whatnot. But, you know, big, big thanks to our helpers, to our MC, to our judges, to our music provider and video provider. They know who they are. we could not have run this contest. Literally, we could not have run this contest without their help.
Exactly. It couldn't have been Amber, me. That would have been a giant disaster. We needed extra hands.
And likewise, big, big thanks to the AllCon staffers, particularly Todd and Jeff, for helping us out, making sure we had everything we needed, you know, making sure that we had the hotel room taken care of, making sure our badges were taken care of. You know, big thanks to Jeff for making sure that the projector and the lights and everything in the room were working as they needed to be, or at least as best as we could get them working, because they didn't actually work as intended, but we got around it.
It's fine.
So, you know, I can't say enough in thanks to all the people that helped us do this. I mean, it really did go shockingly well. I mean, we were just kind of sitting there going, we did it.
We did it.
We did it.
We can add to our resume.
Which, technically, it already is on our resume. If you go to our website on our homepage, I've already put up booking information for us. I already listed in there that we have managed and run a cosplay contest. So.
Nice. Yeah. We're on top of it.
So if anybody else needs help running their cosplay contest, you know, we're available and we done good. So.
We done good, son.
I do believe that we will be back next year for AllCon 2016.
I'm sure we will.
Difficulties.
Right.
Yeah. So you guys will see our faces again next year. Possibly my weird animated face if you've seen the pictures on our Facebook.
Oh, they'll be in this video, not to worry. They will be in this episode.
My public persona is so much more animated than my private persona.
But you were in the moment. You did a really nice job of introducing everybody and getting the show on the road, so it's all good.
We did our thing.
We did our thing. And yep. I actually got a couple of compliments from cosplayers the following day that I just happened to meet walking around, saying, you know, they really thanked us for it being short and efficient, and they felt like, you know, people who won really rightfully deserved to win what they did. So that's good. That's good. I'm glad our judging system worked out so efficiently. That I'm glad.
Yeah, it was some really, really fast mental math there at the end as we were, you know, manually tallying scores, which... That was actually a really big contrast to the computers that were used in the Saturday costume contest.
Yeah. I can math. Which, yay.
Yes. We both mathed really hard and really fast.
Yeah. I brought a calculator that I didn't use. I'm very proud of myself for that.
I didn't even know there was a calculator, but I didn't use one. So algebra is fun, kids. You never know you'd use it for a cosplay contest.
I know. Of all the things, right?
But I will say that, you know, Potters, if you guys have never entered a competition, and I don't say this very often, when we put out the cosplay contest video, which I will be doing shortly, I have to rip it from the digital videotape since, unfortunately, my laptop was in use for the music and videos, and it could not multitask enough to also stream video from the cam. So I have to, you know, rip it, render it, dub it, do all that stuff to it. So it may be this weekend before you see it. But if you see it, go watch the entry for Bob's Burgers. The reason I say this is if you ever wanted to know how to use all 30 seconds on the stage effectively, this is the entry to watch. It's nothing fancy. It's nothing dynamic. It's nothing that anybody could not do. Anybody can do what he did. It was fan-freaking-tastic what he did on the stage. So if you want to know how to use all 30 seconds, go watch that particular entry. He won an award for it.
I know I have permission to use his name. Daryl, bravo. Thank you for paying attention during my very brief description on how to walk the stage, because you did a fantastic job. You made us all proud.
It may feel like an eternity, and to a lot of people it really does feel like an eternity, all 30 seconds. Mm-hmm. But the whole point of that is you're not just doing it for the audience, you're doing it for the judges too, who want to see all of your awesome stuff, because otherwise you wouldn't have entered a contest. And his costume wasn't fancy by any means. It was a very simple costume. So this just goes to show it's not all just about the costume. It's about you moving in the costume.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know,
it's about you being the character.
Yes. So I give you guys that advice. Go watch his particular entry in our contest. You'll thank yourself for it later.
Oh, yeah.
We're still laughing about it afterward. In a good way. Because
in a good way.
It was very entertaining.
It was ridiculously entertaining in all the right ways. And it was so Bob. I think that was what made it even better.
And you can also see the ultimate grand prize winner, the overall best in show. There are many pictures of the Baby Mario Brofist that are also incredibly
cute. Brofist!
Yes, it is incredibly cute. There's a lot of good pictures. You can also go find Jack Teague on Facebook. He was one of the photographers present at the show. He's also got a lot of good pictures of the contestants. I know a lot of people still are processing their photos. I know we certainly are. So it may be a few days before all of them show up on the internet somewhere. So that pretty much ended up being our Friday. We ended up splitting ways, and I went to bed after that because working overnight is kind of hard when you have to go to conventions too.
Right.
And I went home. So then we came back on Saturday morning, you know, all refreshed, rested, fed, and ready for another day of the con.
Yay.
I was a little surprised, and I know I probably shouldn't be, but I was a little surprised Saturday morning that when I was up and walking around, I think it was about 10 a.m., when I was completely out of the hotel room and just, you know, walking the halls already, there weren't very many people. It was like everybody was still in bed. Maybe they partied too hard last night from
watching the
Mulan Shadow Cast. Or maybe it was just because there wasn't anything scheduled until 11 o'clock, because the vendor room didn't open till 11. The panels didn't start till 11. So it was pretty much everybody was either asleep or downstairs in the restaurant eating breakfast.
Yeah, that's what I was told, is that there was a lot of partying going on Friday night that bled into really late Saturday morning. So most people didn't really get up and about until about noon, maybe 1 o'clock.
So I had gotten up a little bit early. And originally I was going to get in costume, but, you know, it's one of those things where you kind of have to consider potential damage to the costume, since I was hauling our stuff around. And I didn't want to damage my costume. So I actually went around the entire con without actually being in cosplay. I wore what could be considered a costume on Saturday, but I wasn't in cosplay. So that said, there really wasn't very much for me to take pictures or video of for haul footage in the morning, because nobody was out and around.
Right, so there wasn't a whole lot out.
So I kind of just vegged and people watched, and actually AllCon is really good for people watching. It's not quite on the level of DragonCon simply because there's not that many people.
Right.
But of all the cons I have ever been to, AllCon is the one where you see the most creative costumes. I mean, look at our photo of the day for today. We have Jay Sherman from The Critic.
Yep.
You won't see that pretty much at any other con except maybe DragonCon. And I love that about this convention. You'll see all sorts of just wacky, random, really creative costumes. And it's really fun to people watch. So sat in a chair, you know, dropped all my gear next to me and just sat there and watched people. And it was awesome.
It's silly, just little things like that. I mean, it makes it so enjoyable and entertaining.
Mm-hmm. And we did end up catching up with our friends later on that morning before we headed into panel. And we filmed the first panel of the day for us was the Worbla Props and Armor panel by Schmall Cosplay. And she was also one of our judges at the Friday night contest. And it's always fun to see other panels like this. I mean, there have been other Worbla panels done by other people, But the whole point of going as, you know, a fellow armorer or prop maker is to see how somebody else does it. Because there's always different ways to do things. There's different perspectives. And I really enjoy seeing that, and I enjoy bringing that to other people. And she did a good job. You know, the lighting in the hotel always leaves some...
That lighting in the hotel sucks. And I tell the staff...
It needs to be fixed.
Every time I'm like, your lighting sucks, guys. And we're like, yeah, we know. We have no control over it. It's like, I get it. Your lighting sucks. And that's why it's taking me so long to get all the photos uploaded. So I'm having to go through and color correct all the flipping yellow out of everything. It is ridiculous.
A lot of hotels do the yellow because it's considered a soothing environment.
Because
if you have white light, it tends to be a little more harsh on the eyes, you know, indoors. So, of course, hotels, they have to have that soothing environment, so they all go yellow. But it's terrible for photography. It really is.
And it's not just cosplay photography. As when I did the wedding, it's all photography. Even when I did wedding photography, I would always beg them to let me just, let's go outside for a couple of minutes and take the nicer photos there. Please! I'll do your crappy reception photos afterwards, but let me get the bride and groom outside where the lighting is like a million times better. Thank you.
Yeah, so more or less we did what we could, you know, as do all photographers that are there. All you can do is white balance and correct later.
Thank you, Photoshop.
And so after the panel was done, basically we had a little bit of time, and so we did some more people watching, you know, took some photos. There were some kids in cosplay that were the most adorable things on the face of this cosplay earth.
Oh my goodness, so many kids in costume, and I took many photos with them, which is probably really creepy since I was dressed up as the evil queen from Snow White, but hey, I will take it.
But the kids seem to really like that. They seem to identify with that a lot more than a lot of the other characters going around. I mean, there were a surprising number of kids that were like, can I have a picture with you?
Uh-huh. Kids and, like and bad it, guys.
Yes, it made my heart very warm that so many parents were bringing their offspring in cosplay. And it actually seemed like a lot of the kids had probably asked their parents if they could go in cosplay instead of the other way around.
Right? I want to dress up like Batman today, Mom. Okay.
I mean, there was everything from superheroes to... There was a Pokemon group.
Oh, yeah. I saw the Pokemon group. Pokemon,
and that was awesome.
When was it? There was one picture that I took that I haven't had a chance to post yet because I'm still editing. Is a mother-daughter duo who is doing a C-3PO and R2-D2. The daughter was R2-D2. So adorable. I don't want kids, but you know what? When my friends have kids, I'll be more than happy to dress them up because it's just cute.
I mean, hey, a mother-son duo won Best in Show at our cosplay contest.
Exactly.
So there is that. And actually, there were a couple of different kids who won prizes at the Saturday costume contest, too, because they actually do have a children's division.
Mm-hmm.
So more or less, after a short break where I went around, took pictures, I mostly vegged because, yay, 40 pounds of filming equipment. And we went to go and film the next panel. Unfortunately, and I do really sincerely apologize to you guys for this, we weren't able to film it with the quality that you guys expect of us, simply because the room it was in echoed like nobody's business. It was like, you know, singing in the bathroom echo. And there were ambient noises outside that I couldn't control. And oddly enough, there were two panels going on simultaneously in that room, which was a little bit awkward because the previous panelist was using an air compressor, which was fine. She was doing some really, really stunning work. I mean, it was like entertaining to watch. Unfortunately, the sound of the air compressor was picked up really strongly by the mic, and it covered up what the other panelist was saying. So we ended up having to dump that panel footage. So I'm really sorry, guys. We couldn't film the mask making. It didn't happen.
Yeah, it is what it is. I mean, I just shrugged my shoulders because, I mean, the second that they said they were going to try to do this while she was air compressing, I was like, there's no way. The footage is completely moot now because we can't hear squat.
Right. So basically, we ended up using that time to kind of take a break, recharge. You know, I went and grabbed dinner real quick because food conventions is important, kids.
It's very important. I ended up changing out a costume. Amber wanted to steal my alpaca again. So it ended up coming around with me around the convention, and it ended up being placed in many cosplayers' hands with photos. So you'll see a lot of photos with my alpaca.
There, and apparently people were asking, like, where you can buy this?
Yes! Three people asked me. Where did I get this?
I had no idea that people would be so interested in something that I did as what I thought would be a one-off birthday present.
Now it's a two-off birthday present.
Now it's going to be a two-off, because now I'm going to turn her alpaca into Wyndham from Magic Knight Rare to go with her foo costume. So I'm going to armor an alpaca. This is going to be epic. I'm going to get so many commission requests off of this.
You are.
If this works out the way I think it does, I'm going to get so many commission requests.
Because it started really innocently. I had the alpaca underneath my arms. For those who haven't seen it, it's like Amidala in the black decoy gown outfit from episode 1. And it was just under my arm. R2-D2 was right there because I always have an R2-D2, you know, robotics guy there. This time it was a robotics chick dressed up as Han Solo. And I was like, you know what? I'll take a photo of R2-D2. I'll just stick the alpaca right out there, take a photo, no problem. The Han Solo lady was freaking out, squealing. Like, oh my god, this thing is so cute. This is so cute. This is so cute. I'm like, do you want to hold the alpaca? And then just kind of spurred from there. Everybody touched the alpaca.
I will be the alpaca outfitter eventually.
Ah!
It'll be the new ball-jointed dolls.
Exactly. I mean, at this point, everybody is dressing up their amiibos. I mean, I kind of want to go back to the alpacas. Oh. Let's dress up the alpacas.
If anybody is interested in this, if I ever get a duct tape pattern for it, if you have an alpaca that's the same way, you can always message me and I'll talk commissions. Can't promise I'll take any, though, just due to free time. But, yeah, that was just... It was really flattering. I had no idea that it would be so popular. I really didn't. But I am kind of... I am kind of happy.
See? And there was one lady that I was talking to, it just happened to be walking by, and she just wanted a picture of the alpaca, just that by itself. And I was like, okay. They were really impressed by your work.
To be fair, I did a good job.
You did a great job. I've never changed it. I mean, it's still got its stupid little purple pink bandana on that I never bothered to take off.
Yeah, I noticed that.
Whoops. But it's still adorable.
It is. It definitely works. It's nesting in my room awaiting, you know, another pattern-making session.
Right. It was sitting right next to my Amidala headdress, and now I have this blank space next to her, and it's just like, aw, that's depressing.
Should have taken a picture of it and just put the picture up where it was.
You know what? I have so many pictures of him now. Maybe I should just blow one of those up and stick it right there.
Yeah, just here. There. I won't have it long. You'll have it back by Akon, obviously.
Oh, obviously, obviously. I'm not too concerned about it. It's just like, oh, there's a blank spot there. It's kind of depressing.
All right. And so then we finished up on Saturday. Actually, right before, I think it was right before the contest, we were actually interviewed.
Yay!
We were interviewed by Trade Paper Hacks. And yes, I'm going to name drop, because those guys are awesome.
Aren't they awesome? I told you they were awesome.
They're very friendly guys, very outgoing, and dirty.
But dirty in a clean way. I know that sounds kind of weird because they don't swear like sailors like I do late in the evening. It's guy humor.
It was enough to make me very much blush on the inside because I have a lot of trouble blushing on the outside. But I blushed on the inside.
I snorted a lot. That's all I really remember.
Especially when they were like, yeah, you know you have this habit that you're not aware of, and I'm sitting there going, oh, God.
You knew what was going to happen.
I knew. No, because I know that I'm very expressive with my hands.
Yes.
And I've
you
been like that
with your
for
body.
Years. I am aware of it. It's not that I'm not aware of it. I am aware of it. But he was like, you were doing this particular gesture, and I'm sitting there going, dude, I have low bust. I cannot help that happens to be at the same height as where my hands are, more or less. You know, my chest is more or less the same height that I have my hands at natural level. So it's not that I'm trying to empathize myself. It's that that's my body.
Yeah.
I'm not ashamed of it. That's just the way I'm built.
It was just funny the way that he worded it. It was like, okay, I see where he's getting at.
Yeah.
It's not meant to be offensive.
Eyes up, Steve. Up here. But the interview went really well. You know, more exposure for us, more exposure for them. All is good. And
exactly.
And it was a learning experience for everybody. Plus, we got to drool over their equipment.
I know, right? I still think they need to get the Bob Barker microphone. That would be hilarious. Particularly for Alex, because Alex is just a special, special cupcake. He's not a snowflake. He's a cupcake.
Mmm.
I know, right? Cupcake. Mm.
No, but they were good folks.
They were. So thank you again, Trade Paper Hacks. Again, we're going to spam you with, hey, everybody, go visit their webpage. Go to their website. They're a podcast. They're awesome. They're clean podcasts, too, so we approve.
Yes, they are CosPod approved. And once we had finished up, you know, taking care of our interview, which basically we were asked about the cosplay contest, so we went to go film the costume contest, which is the one that AllCon runs themselves. You know, they sponsor it, they have cash prizes, they give away trophies and whatnot. And so it was in the same room as the mask making. So unfortunately, when you guys hear the audio, there's going to be echo. We're sorry, there's not much we can do about it. But two things that surprised me, for good or bad. The first was that this is the first time that they used computer scoring. They had laptops for all of the judges. They set up their own private network, wireless network, hooked everybody up. They got it running fairly quickly, considering what it was they were doing.
Mm-hmm. And I can see why they do it based off of past years. It was meant to help speed up the scoring process, because that was the most time-consuming portion of the event, was them sitting there tabulating the scores. But now that you have all 5 to 6 judges doing it at once, computer does it all for you, bam, done.
Yep. And I admit, it was rather risky of mm-hmm. them, because if anything had failed in that chain, they would have been back to paper ballots again.
Exactly.
So I will assume that they tested this beforehand, so kudos to them for doing that. You know, bravo. And it seemed to work really well. The only problem with it was that it caused them to start late. Quite a bit late. I believe it was 15 minutes late.
Oh, no, it was more than that.
Oh, was it more? 6:15 was the last time I looked at my watch.
Ah.
So, to be honest, I don't even know what time they started. All I know is that I saw audience members kind of starting to get a little antsy. And the host, you know, poor Neil. I feel kind of bad for him. But he did a decent job trying to stall for them, just so that they could basically not start losing people. Because there were a lot of kids in the audience, too.
Mm.
And kids don't have the largest patience in the world. So they did the best that they could.
Sure.
Just
Neil's a good sport.
I honestly think that they should not have scheduled the Cosplay Gallifrey photo shoot right before them in the same room. They should have blocked off that entire hour for cosplay contest setup instead of starting the setup after 5:30. And contest was supposed to start at 6. Half hour for setup for that kind of setup? Probably not going to happen unless you've got a full team of AV guys instead of convention security doing it. Which, to be fair, a lot of those convention security guys, from what I saw, seem to know what they were doing.
Mm-hmm.
I believe them. I believe that they know what they were doing. But I think that if they wanted to set it up that quick, they should have had a dedicated team. Just bam. So I think those were the only downsides that I will discuss publicly. I mean, there was some behind-the-scenes stuff that, you know, we're not going to air out anybody's dirty laundry.
Dirty laundry. No.
So let's put it that way. There was one very odd entry, and actually, this may be an example of what not to do during your 30 seconds, and Val knows what I'm about to say.
I'm going to pretend I'm not listening. I'm not listening.
So basically, the entry for Back to the Future, Marty McFly, if you watch that entry, it's probably a good example of what not to do. And the reason I say this is because, you know, he read from a handwritten letter, which is cool. You know, not all contests allow contestants to speak. This one does. Reading from a letter is not necessarily a bad thing. He tried to make political jokes in the letter because it wasn't directly from the movie. He made a crack that he shouldn't have. The host of the contest, Neil, tried to get him to stop. The guy didn't stop. He kept going, and he went well over his 30 seconds. He was probably a good 2 minutes on stage. And by that point, just the audience had fallen off the cliff, and it was real hard getting them back. So, you know, compared to Bob's Burgers, just night and day.
So I'm impressed with the guy who followed him up. He brought everybody back up.
Chef,
so
right?
That was good for him, right? Yep, the chef.
Okay. This is Chef from South Park, kids. If you didn't know which chef we're referencing, it's the guy from South Park. Which, he ended up winning an award.
He did good. He kept it simple. He kept it on point.
He kept it in character, which was very important.
Very, very important.
So, they had several categories. And you guys can, you know, either watch their website or watch our video for the list of winners. Which, you know, we'll have to watch the video ourselves to get that list. Because I don't remember all of them offhand. But they don't do the same thing that we did. Basically, they give away a trophy. And the reserve Best in Show and the Best in Show are the only ones who get cash prizes.
Mm-hmm.
They don't give away a prize bundle to each of the winners. They give trophies.
Which is fine. There's nothing wrong with that. Mm-hmm. I am a trophy person, so to have a trophy, I'm like, that's all I want. All I want is the trophy.
And the trophies were actually rather spiffy looking. They
yeah.
looked like they... I know they weren't cast in bronze, but they had that look to it, which I mm-hmm. thought was really neat. It was almost pewter looking. And they went ahead. They went through their winners. The giving away of the prizes actually went quicker than the contest did itself.
Oh, yeah.
They
Much
just
quicker.
Went bam, 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 bam. They were moving. Mm-hmm. And they didn't have contestants stay up on stage for photos this time, which... didn't really surprise me as much because they knew they were running overtime, which they did by a pretty significant amount. But some of the contestants, I wish they would have stood still longer. It's like, wait, we want your picture. Stand still.
Hopefully I don't have too many blurry photos in that mess. That's the one thing I like about having the mirrorless is that I can literally just keep the button pressed on the shutter and go like literally like a Gatling gun. It just keeps on going until I stop. So hopefully I got some non-blurries.
I understand that there are 500 photos of a certain Best in Show pair of rafters.
Oh, yes. The rafters got tons of attention because of where I was sitting, too, because I was really the only photographer who was brave enough to go next to the judges' tables. Everybody was kind of sitting either behind me or off to the corner, so you got some nice scenic shots. But I was like, no, I want to be up front and center. I want to take the inappropriate shots where I'm, like, sitting down here at weird angles. The judges waved to me multiple times, but yeah, I think in doing so, I got one too many photos of the raptors from Jurassic Park. Not that it was a bad thing, because I got some amusing photos of Neil making the WTF face while Scotty, who is one of the raptors, is looking at him like, I'm about ready to eat you, buddy.
Well, that was because the entire audience started chanting, eat Neil,
eat Neil.
Eat Neil.
And I have a great photo of him going up to the judges and one of the judges coming out and trying to pet him. And I was like, hey, no one else got a photo of that but me.
And I'm sure that, you know, there were very few photos of them actually going up to him to eat him.
It's good being a photographer sometimes.
There was a third thing that surprised me. For Alcon being a family show, they actually gave him scotch twice.
Twice!
And he drank it. That,
good man.
You know, more power to them. If they choose to do it, they're adults. It just surprised me with kids present that they not only served him scotch, but that he drank it in front of them. And it was like, wow, okay.
You know what? It didn't bug me as much because after having experienced the epicness that is Dragon Con and you see the drinking everywhere with kids all over the place, I was like, you know what? As long as adults are responsible, that it doesn't bother me anymore.
Sure, and nothing came of it.
I was surprised. It's just like, hey, Scotch, all right.
It was fairly obvious who was going to win Best in Show in that contest just as soon as I got up on stage.
Oh, yeah.
It was just a matter of the winners of the other categories.
And I was able to actually, afterwards, since I know the people who won, they both did a fantastic job. I was able to get up close and take more photos of some of their paintwork. And I think, Amber, you'll be really impressed by their paint job up close and personal. And they did a phenomenal amount of painting on that sucker.
Mm-hmm. So basically, that was the end of my AllCon. At that point, I had to go home because I had stuff to get done around the house so I can get ready for work again.
I went back on Sunday like I always do. So Sunday was, you know how Sundays are at cons. Sunday's like the chill out day. It's the relaxing. Everybody's packing up, getting ready to go, all that business. I came in as April O'Neil that day, and very appropriately, I went to their Saturday morning cartoon session, which is basically they throw together all the theme songs and commercials from like the 70s and 80s. And I walked into the room, and the Ninja Turtles theme song was playing. I was like, yep. I came in at a great time. This is going to be a good day. That's essentially how my day went. That was really the only panel I sat in on. I just kind of did a lot of wandering up the hallways, try to collect any cosplayers that I could find, say goodbye to a couple of people. I was able to sit in on the Rebel Legion's photo shoot again. That's always a joy to just see who shows up for that. And I even sat in on the Harry Potter trivia challenge, which was very strange because my knowledge of Harry Potter is like that big. I've only read the first book, haven't seen any of the movies. But it was really cool to see the entire room filled, a room of 100 people filled for Harry Potter stuff on a Sunday morning at 11. I was like, wow, this is kind of cool. So I took as many pictures as I possibly could. And I actually have a purchase. I have not made a purchase at a convention in a really long time. I have purchased myself a new lunchbox. It is Star Wars themed. It was very appropriate. I have a photo of this on my phone. I will attach it to this episode. And I may have to give a shout out to the vendor who made them because they're all homemade. It worked surprisingly well. It was really well made, very well sewn. She promised me a 2-year warranty on the sucker, so if anything happens to it, I can send it to her, which is awesome. And the way that it's insulated is actually pretty normal for most coolers that you'll find out on the market. So I was like, okay, I'll give this a shot. Worked really well today for my lunch, so thank you, lady. And that was my welcome.
And speaking of shout-outs, shout-out to Shadow Slayer. Hey, dude, we'll see you at Project Akon.
Yeah, exactly. Hi.
He came up to us several times at the con. So.
Oh, yeah. It was good. It was a good experience. It's like how all con usually is. It's a nice, relaxing, chill-out con where you can talk to new people, you can hang out with friends, and you just get to see a lot of really unique takes on costumes. I think the one thing that we both probably could agree on is that with the costume contest, spinning was the theme. We had two dresses that spun around.
Transformations.
I'll say spinning. I like spinning better because spinning is more fun. There was one from Catching Fire from the Hunger Games series, which was the beautiful, you know, black Mockingjay dress. And the way she did her panels for the flames was really cool, very unique. And then the other one was Cinderella, where she transforms from her peasant girl self into her ball gown dress. Really smart way of how she did the top so it tucks underneath the dress. I noticed that in her second time spinning. I was like, that's smart. How did you make that happen?
And we have video of both, so if you ever want to play them back in slow-mo, you can see kind of how they did it.
I also took lots of pictures.
That works too. So that aside, you know, another fantastic year for AllCon. I can't really give them any complaints since pretty much my only complaints had to do with the hotel itself. Parking was a big problem, as it always has been for the last few years with the Crown. Well, it's with the Crown Plaza in particular.
Yeah.
Because they were over capacity.
Oh, yeah. But that's always the case. It always has been. They're moving.
At least. Yeah. And that was one of my beefs with them, is the parking. But my only other beef with them, and this doesn't happen every year, so I can't really criticize because it was a one-off event, was not only the apparent lack of, but the scheduling of the cosplay panels. There weren't very many cosplay panels this year, and they were all clustered on Saturday. So basically, there was nothing on Friday. And I think there was one, or I'm sorry, there were panels on Friday, but they were repeated on Saturday.
Mm-hmm.
And then there was one on Sunday. And I felt kind of bad because I know that we have so many talented cosplayers in the area that could offer content. So, you know, that was kind of my only other, it's not even really a beef. It's just, you know, I would prefer to see more.
Sure.
But that's my bias as a cosplayer.
And I think that this year, I noticed that they did do a lot of new panels. There were different panels, which is great. I think we just like to see a couple more costuming panels. I mean, I know Amber and I have both talked about potentially teaching there. I think if we didn't have the costume contest, cosplay contest, my apologies, in our plates, we probably would have taken on another one of those panels, but maybe next year, I don't know, now that we have time to think and all that stuff.
If, you know, if we do it again next year, and we have more time to plan, then I'm heavily considering offering one or two panels in addition to the cosplay contest.
Right.
So, you know, there is that. I did not have the time this year at all.
Oh, heck no.
I
don't know how we're going to plan for ACON at this point, because already I can't do one of Amber's panels, because it's like, great, you schedule it once again on top of the photo shoot that I always host.
And I had to drop the photo shoot because my panel scheduled on top of it, which I can't really complain because, you know, ACON approved all my panels. That doesn't always happen. So I'm grateful that they approved them in the first place. I can't complain about the scheduling. One of my panels is going to move because I was approved as cosplay staff, so I have to help with the costume contest at ACON, which means I can't have any of my panels overlapping it. So that one's going to have to move. But I can't even start doing anything panel-wise until after April 15th.
After tax day.
Well, tax day just happened to be a coincidence. My IT cert has to be taken by then.
Mm.
And pretty much all my waking free time. I mean, I'll still have to take mental breaks, obviously. I'm not going to be studying IT for every waking minute. But the majority of my time needs to be spent studying for that exam because it's $600. And if I fail, I have to pay $600 again. So after that's done, then I can actually start doing ACON stuff, which basically means I'm going to have a month and a half. A month and a half to do what I had thought would be 3 costumes and 3 panels. Awesome. Why the heck did I bite off more than I can chew again?
Pace yourself. Just get done what you can get done. Don't go psychotic, please.
No. And I may end up, you know, I'll still have Cosmos. It's just a matter of whether or not we're going to have gear to haul around again.
We'll find out soon enough. We'll see. We'll make magic happen.
Yeah. If I have to spruce up some of my existing costumes, it's fine. But this was one of those times in life when I realized that not only am I getting older, but my metabolism is starting to slow down, and I can tell. Because working overnights, by the time I get home, I basically sleep. I don't have any sort of energy to go work out. So, you know, it's starting to show a lot that I haven't worked out in several months. And, you know, as cosplayers, that not only affects what you feel comfortable wearing in public, because I don't want to show fat in public. You know, yes, you can sit there and say, you know, we accept all cosplayers, all body types, we're all beautiful people. Fine and good, but the reality is society doesn't accept that yet. And I feel uncomfortable going out, you know, showing things that I don't like about myself. But it also affects the fit of your cosplay. And a lot of my costumes have been constructed years ago, back when I was not quite as big as I am now. So they don't necessarily fit the way they used to. Ah, the life of getting older as a cosplayer.
Yay! Well, I mean, it goes the opposite way, too, because, I mean, you know that I've been sick over the past couple of months, and I noticed this with my Evil Queen dress the first time I finally put it on, because it's been a couple of months. I was like, oh, hell, it doesn't fit the same, because I've lost weight in places that I didn't mean to. Because, again, I've been sick. It's not like I wanted to lose the weight. It just kind of came with the territory, and it's like, crap, I got to take it in again. I don't really want to take it in, because I'm going to screw up the satin.
Yeah, it's one of those things where, you know, it's nature. Our bodies
Yeah.
will react to what we put in them and what we don't, what we do to them and what we don't.
Or what comes out of them when you really don't want it to come out of
That too. And, you know, this will be my 15th year of cosplay, so I'm really starting to be an elder in terms of the cosplay world. Not that I'm old, but I've been cosplaying longer than some attendees have been alive.
You've been cosplaying for like almost half your life.
Pretty much. In fact, it's a little bit less since I just turned another year older within the last 2 weeks.
Yeah.
So, yay.
Happy
I'm older.
birthday, Amber!
I'm older now. Yay.
Yay.
Older, a little bit wiser, quite a bit grayer.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'm not going to stop cosplaying, obviously.
Good.
It's too much fun. And I still have many, many plans. It's just a matter of my budget supporting them at this point, because life has this tendency. It's like somebody must be watching my bank account to see when I have money, because then all of these bills suddenly pile on me that I didn't expect.
Right?
So
Stupid
I'm
life.
still dealing with that. So when my budget supports it, I'll be able to do what I need to do. But, you know, Val was kind enough to give me a fabric.com gift certificate for my birthday, and I
Welcome.
won an Arta gift card from Danielle, which was also right about the time of my birthday, so that was kind of a nice birthday gift. So, you know, it helps. Every little bit helps, because good wigs are not cheap, and good fabric is also not cheap.
Oh, snap, that you said that. Hang on, keep talking. I'll be right back.
Of course, granted, you know, I also keep seeing all these new costumes I want to do. As, you know, anime progresses, as series progress, you know, there's a new Wonder Woman comic cover for the new upcoming comic storyline with her. And I looked at it and I was like, dude,
Isn't
I
that
want to
really
add
cool?
that. I love it. I love the new design. I
I do
love that
too.
it's both sexy and modest at the same time. I like the new modifications in armor because I'm in armor. And, you know, there are other things like, you know, Lady Sif got an armor upgrade. And I sat there looking at it going, oh, now I want to redo it. I want to do it right. Because I retired that costume. You know, the swords that I made are falling apart. I didn't do half of it the way that I wanted it to. Parts of it didn't even fit right because I was doing it literally the night before the con and I hadn't had a chance to sit down and pattern it out and fit it. And, you know, all of us have costumes we're unhappy with. That was a particular one I was unhappy with. So I see all these things and it's like, oh, I want to redo it. I want to redo all these things. All the things.
All the things. Yeah.
But sadly, it takes money and time.
And time.
So I have to picky choosy.
Picky choosy. I like that. So there's the color wheel of Doom. I will send you
Woo!
photos afterwards. Yes, this is all their,
Yeah.
all but three of their current wig colors. So there you go.
Yeah.
Whee!
The two that I think I need are on back order and won't be here until April.
And which is probably okay because you don't really need them until May-ish.
Probably May.
I'll have to pull
And
out the names and colors on this.
I need maroon and ash blonde.
Okay, remind me in a couple minutes because the one thing I dislike, I love Arta's color wheel. It is brilliant. I love the fact that you can get so many for such a good price. However, it's all done by their item numbers. It's not done by the actual title. So it's like, oh crap, I gotta search by their item numbers to find the correct name. It's like, ugh, thanks. Not really convenient, but you know, whatever. I'm glad I still got this though. I got this with a gift card.
Plus,
Best
I'm
purchase
hoping
ever.
that they'll have a sale between now and May.
Yeah, maybe a spring or an Easter sale or something.
I'm hoping Easter because I have basically to save money right now. For those who have never worked with wigs that are not meant for ponytails, if you try and take a base wig and pull it back into a ponytail, you start to see the wefts and the netting underneath the wig because human hair does not all point down. It grows out in several different directions. We comb it in one direction to make it look that way. But if you have bedhead in the morning, you'll notice that you wake up and your hair is going all different directions. That's how it naturally goes. When you have wigs, all of the wefts are sewn with the hair pointing down. So when you try and point the hair in a direction that it wasn't originally sewn in, like say backward, then you start seeing the understructure, and that's usually not desirable.
Mm-hmm.
And the only two ways to fix that are, one, you have to put in more wefts to cover that up, so you have to put in hair wefts going in the direction of the ponytail, or you have to get a wig that is specifically built to be pulled back in a ponytail, which, you know, they'll sell ponytail wigs.
Mm-hmm.
For those that aren't built that way, you'll find that a lot of people do what is called stubbing, which is, you know, trimming a wig short, pulling up the remaining fibers to the back of the head, you know, and gluing it so that it's stiff.
Right.
And then covering up the understructure, you know, with those wefts so that it looks like it was originally meant to be that way. And then you have a clippy that you put on the back for the ponytail. So the wigs that I currently have, I can't stub because I still need them to be long for the characters which they need to be long for. I don't have enough money to buy two separate wigs. I have to multi-use one wig. So I found this really neat tutorial that is on cosplayisland.co.uk. It's a British site. And they have a really neat ponytail tutorial where it has you pulling the wig into a low ponytail, flipping it up, kind of like you would your own hair when you put it under a wig, pinning it into the wig, and then clipping the ponytail on top of that so that you have a nice smooth look since all the hair fibers are pointing down, and then having the ponytail come out the back. It looks a little fake if you understand what's going on, but I can't really complain, and it's a great way of being able to use your wig for multiple characters if you're like me and can't afford to buy multiple wigs.
And that's actually one of the reasons why so many people like to use Arda. One, they use additional wefts that most companies don't use. It's also why you're paying a little bit more, because you're getting a lot of wig for such a little bundle. The other thing is that they're one of the few companies that actually make wigs specifically for styling, for making the ponytails, for stubbing, and all that stuff. So you can get the wigs pre-built at actually pretty good prices, too, by comparison, because that stuff is not cheap, and it is not easy to do by yourself. That is for sure. You need to be a wig aficionado and mess up a lot of wigs to get to that level.
And Arda is also nice about putting tutorials on their website.
Mm-hmm. They're really good about it.
They have forums that are just filled with tutorials, and you can always go on there and ask about specific character wigs. If you're working on a specific one, you can say, hey, I'm working on this wig. How do I do this?
Right.
And they'll tell you. And if you ever want to see what people are capable of doing with wigs, watch the Iron Wig Contest.
The one they have going on this year is already nutty enough. I'm like, dude, all right, this is a whole new ball game of wig work.
Insane.
It is.
The wigs are as complicated as a costume in and of themselves. And they're doing this with a single base wig and one pack of wefts. That's it. They're doing amazing things. But it's really cool. It's really, really cool.
Yeah, it is. It's really flipping cool. So anyway,
other than
that's our review of Alcon.
That is our review of Alcon and of Arda Wigs.
Yay!
So let's go ahead and move on. We did an interview with the ever awesome Punished Props, Bill Doran. He actually
the king
just
of foam.
Yes, he is the king of foam. He just finished up. He now has a paper edition of his foam smithing volume. At first, he actually had volumes 1, 2, and 3 as ebooks, which you can still get on his website for a very affordable price. But he now has a paper edition that you can pre-order on his website, which is punishedprops.com. And it's just, it's a tome. It's a lovely, photo-filled, beautifully instructable tome of everything that you would ever want to know about making props and armor with foam. And we highly recommend getting it. It's very worth the price that you pay for it, whether it's the ebook or the printed book, if you prefer to have a physical book in your hand. But he gave us a fantastic interview, and we would like to present that to you guys right now.
Enjoy this segment.
Hey
Hey Potters, we have another extra special interview for you guys. This episode, we are here with Bill Doran of Punished Props, and we are thrilled to have him on the show. Welcome, Bill.
Yay!
Hey guys, how you doing today?
We're freezing.
We're freezing over.
It's snowing outside in Texas. This is a very unusual event for us. It's like legit snow, too. It's not sleet. It's powder snow.
That's crazy, because I'm in Seattle, and my wife is actually outside mowing the lawn. It's so nice out.
No. This is like, hi, my dogs are only out for 5 seconds to use the bathroom and run back in because it's too freaking cold. Yeah. It's bad. Yeah. It's bad.
Wow. So wait. All right. So, but this is like...
There we go.
Like Texas. How cold is Texas cold? Like, how many degrees in Fahrenheit is Texas cold?
Right now, I think we're at 32. We were 28 yesterday.
That's legitimately cold.
Yeah. It's like cold for us is maybe about mid-50s. So this is ridiculously cold.
Wow. And I'm from Chicago. If the camera doesn't reach her, I'd show you outside my window. It looks like a winter wonderland outside.
It's really nice for photos.
All right. So... First and foremost, welcome to you. You are known as the Foamsmith in the cosplay community, and you have come out with a new series called Foamsmithing.
Mm-hmm, that's right.
Very cool. First, I wanted to congratulate you. I understand that you are working on print copies now.
Oh, yeah. We are diving into the realm of real physical products, which is
nice.
Really exciting and really cool. We got the print version of it. I wrote a trilogy of 3 ebooks for the Foamsmith trilogy. We combined them, and when I say we, I mean my wife did it because she works really hard and she's awesome. And to combine it into a single tome, it's something like almost 200 pages, big old book thing, and we got a proof from the printer, and I'm like, wow, it's a real thing. It's amazing. Because when you work on the internet, so you send this stuff out into the ether via electrons, and you don't really get a sense that you're really making something, but when you have it in your hands, So yeah, the Foamsmith series is now going to be a print book. People seem to be very excited about that. We'll be doing pre-orders on punishedprops.com very soon. Possibly on Monday.
Awesome.
Yeah, so
cool.
Keep your ear to the ground.
So definitely keep your eyes on that. What is the process like of writing books?
Well, all right, I'll let you in a little bit behind the scenes when I first got started into doing it. Because I don't have any training as a writer. I have done lots of writing, though. I guess that's right, training as a writer. I wrote lots and lots of blog entries for all the build write-ups for everything I make. I build props for a living and costumes for myself and all that. So I got a lot of experience doing that. And then I wanted to write like the single prop maker's tome, like an ebook, and spend like a year developing it, make this really amazing thing. And I went to a friend of mine who's done that. He's a magician, and he wrote a book about magicking stuff. I said, hey, buddy. My buddy Brian, I want to write this book. It's going to be amazing and comprehensive. And he was like, well, let's stop you right there. So you are not an author and no one cares. No one will care if you write this book. He said, instead, write a book really fast, publish it yourself, and just get it out there. Just get familiar with the process, get a product finished, get it out there. So I did that with my first ebook. I sat down, I went through all my old blog entries, and I pulled all the best information out and wrote what I called the Beginner's Guide to Prop Making. And I put it out there, and people liked it. I sold it for like $5 as an ebook on my website, and people enjoyed it. So I wrote more and more, and I just kept iterating, kept getting better at the writing process, making it look a lot better, because that first one looked terrible. I wrote it in Google Docs. And that's basically how it was. I just kept building on the last project, getting better at it, spending more time on it, taking better photographs for my book, until we now finally have... like 2.5 years later, a product that I would consider good enough to put on paper. There you go. That's all it takes, everyone. If you want to become a writer, it just takes 2 to 3 years. Just start now.
And for those who would like to purchase the book and take pre-orders, it is, of course, all available on punishedprops.com.
That's correct.
There's a lovely store down there. You guys should definitely visit it. Again, the ebooks are very affordable, you know, price of maybe a cup of coffee at Starbucks.
Or one of these micro-brewed, cold-brewed coffees I have. Like, seriously, this almost costs as much as one of my $5 ebooks. And
indeed. And the books go farther.
It's pretty good. Like, the coffee's okay, but...
The book's better.
Better investment, I would say.
There you go.
Fair enough. Now, of course, we do encourage people to get the book. What would you like people to take away from reading your book?
A lot of, most of the questions I get from people, they say, like, oh, I really want to get into cosplay. I've never done it before. Where do I start? And they have this expectation, because when you look on the internet, you see these finished products, or you go to a convention, you see, like, Bumblebee, it's a crazy giant armor thing, and you think, oh, there's no way I could do that. That's a lot of work. I don't know where to start. So I wrote the ebook guides as a way to lower the barrier to entry. Say, guys, it's not that hard. Don't start with a Bumblebee costume. That's crazy. Start with something you love, but something that is more realistic. But by lowering that barrier to entry, you say, here's some cheap materials. Here's some cheap tools, some easy techniques, things that get you started, so that you can start building that skill set and start working your way towards some of those bigger, more elaborate costumes. But that was originally my goal with the whole ebook series, and people seem to be running with it, which is great.
Hopefully you guys enjoyed that preview of the full interview, which you guys can actually see in the after session for this episode. We're not doing a formal after session because, unfortunately, I have to sleep. But we hope you guys enjoy the entire interview. It was really fun to film with him. He's a really fun guy.
If you're watching this on YouTube, just click the link down here, and that'll take you to the after session where you can see the full interview.
You can also watch his blog on Facebook, which if you just search for Punished Props, you'll find him. But he finished his Destiny armor.
I know.
Along with custom printed bodysuit, which...
So happy!
People be pinged to see that.
Oh,
but
yeah.
He did a really good job, especially with the paint job on the armor. We highly encourage you guys to go take a look on his YouTube channel. Not only does he do tutorials, but he also did basic live streams of him actually making that armor, so you can see him make all his mistakes, you can see him cuss, you can see him bodily injure himself in the process of
making it. Okay, that's probably not the highlight.
I know. But basically, you can see the, in real time, here is how it actually goes down, and
right.
It's not the polished process that you guys may think it is. I mean, we're cosplayers, this is life. It doesn't always go as intended. So
exactly.
It's really entertaining to watch sometimes. No, the finished product is just, I can't say enough about it.
It's glorious.
I am in love. And it's probably really comfortable, too.
Well, yeah, it's foam.
Exactly, which is one of the benefits of foam.
Yay!
All right, so now we have one other topic for you guys.
Cosplay news?
Yes, this is kind of our cosplay news, in that our Facebook feeds exploded with the advent of Transparent Worbla.
Yay, Transparent Worbla! Woo! I swear, this must be the only thing that we were talking about all flipping weekend at all con was Transparent Worbla!
Everybody was asking us about it.
Yeah!
And
as if we had some insight that they didn't.
It just came out. We haven't had a chance to play with it yet. But basically, it is a mostly clear form of the ever-popular thermoplastic. The way that they show it being used, mostly, is almost a form of vacuforming without the vacuum. It's you place it over an object and you use a heat gun and basically melt it to the face of an object to get a cast. And they do show other uses of it, for example, making solid gems with it. If you take all the scraps and, heat them up, roll them up, and roll them together. And it has sort of a frosted look, like frosted beach glass, which would work really well for lighting them up because it's more diffuse than just transparent Worbla, which is better if you need a clear effect. So the way they advertised it was that you could use it for making... ice-based weapons or clear gems that have to be able to light up, that sort of thing. So, Val, if you would like to wax eloquently about this.
Wax on and wax off. Because you guys have noticed, like, I don't know if I said it the last episode or the episode or before that, I pretty much swore off Worbla. because I was just so detesting it on so many different levels that I was like, you know what, I don't want to deal with this mess anymore. And then this popped up on my feed, and it's like, oh, man. Because there's one thing you guys have to know about me. You guys already know that I don't like armor. I don't like making props. I do, however, like to disassemble Christmas ornaments and use those as, like, my gems, because they're fantastic for giant balls of random stuff. I mean, just take a Christmas ornament, slice it in half, done. Easy peasy, no problem. And I've been using it for a lot of my props, and even in my Evil Queen outfit, that giant gem in the middle, it's a Christmas ball. It's perfect. And now the transparent Worbla is here, I can already see applications for using it and to replace all of my resin crap with this. Because one thing I dislike about resin, in particular being in Texas, is the heat. No matter how well your resin sets, there's always the potential that it's going to start bending or melting because of Texas heat. And it's just, it is what it is. And I'm seeing transparent Worbla as a potential to resolve that. Because no matter how often I cover or try to keep the resin from not bending or melting and all that stuff, it still does it. With Worbla, I have yet to have that experience. I've been able to secure it with either gesso or Mod Podge or something to prevent that from happening. And I'm sure that there's a way for me to do this with the transparent Worbla that I don't have to worry about it bending or cracking or flaking or turning into a pile of goo like resin. So I can see applications. I can see small applications for it. Now, as far as making like a giant suit of armor out of it, probably not. Maybe I'll use the rest like they did it with skulls. I could use that for Halloween props. That would be kind of handy considering how expensive Halloween props can get. So I don't know. I'm more than likely end up buying myself a small sheet. I'm going to try it. It'll probably end up in my food costume. We'll see what happens. I don't know. But I'm going to try it.
Well, also, they had mentioned if you go to the product page for the transparent Worbla that it takes a higher temperature to form it than standard Worbla. So that means it can also withstand higher temperatures if for some reason you forget and leave it in your car.
They also
less chance it will melt.
Yeah, they also recommended that instead of using your hands like most people do, that you do it with rubber gloves because it's transparent. Your fingerprints are more likely to show up on the transparent Worbla. I think they also recommended having like a wet cloth or something available, specifically so if you do have a fingerprint or something that shows up, you can easily wipe it and it'll somehow magically stick back together again like Worbla does. And the fingerprint will go away. So it seems like you're going to have more equipment and more materials to work with the stuff, but I'd be okay with that trade-off if I can get gems that would last longer, that'll look more like what I want them to do, and not have to deal with all the smelly resin that inevitably will fail 50% of the time.
You can always go with plastic gems.
I am cool with plastic gems. If I can find them big enough, that's my big problem, is that I'm cheap. I don't want to spend the money on certain gems. That's why I use Christmas ornaments, because it's cheap. Really cheap.
Yeah, I usually use plastic beads wholesale, unless I need something very large, and then I have to go looking.
Yeah, we can all say this with staves, or like a Sailor Moon staff, where you need like a ball this ridiculously oversized, and you want it to be transparent, and you're like, okay, well, what are my options?
I know where to find those.
Oh.
That there are plastic manufacturers that you can get those from.
Yeah, how expensive are they? Yeah, she's biting her finger, so that's
I could probably find them cheaply if I really had to.
Yeah, see, that's the thing. It's like, how much money are you willing to spend on it?
Not much.
Exactly.
I'm always stingy. I don't like spending money. I don't even like spending my own money, or anybody else's money, for that matter. You give me $20, I'm sitting there going, okay, how do I get the most bang for my buck?
Right? So that's why I could see where transparent Worbla could come in as an alternative for those of us who need the funky-looking gems, but we don't have the right materials or don't have the right product to make them happen.
If you're willing to pay the price for that Worbla.
Exactly.
Because it's still Worbla.
It's still Worbla.
Name brand, you're going to pay for it. It's unknown at this time. You can still order it from Worbla's Finest Arts, obviously, overseas. It isn't known yet whether or not the other places that typically carry Worbla... The comic shops in Austin and Conroe are the ones I'm specifically thinking of. I don't know if they're going to carry it yet.
Yeah, we don't know yet, but I do know because I saw this on their website. CosplaySupplies.com is already selling it. Right.
No, I'm thinking of the smaller shops where you go, you know, walk up and get it in person.
Sure, yeah. They probably don't have it quite yet. I would imagine since it just got announced and it's just been released, it's probably going to be a little bit.
Yep. But if you want to have it, you can always go look at CosplaySupplies.com and take a look for it.
I wonder if it's backordered.
Oh, jeez.
Time to Google. Hang on, we got to look now. I'm curious. CosplaySupplies.com.
I'm already beating you to it.
I'm sure you are.
Does not appear to be backordered yet.
Yet. Cool.
Now, that said, they have a note on here saying that availability is not expected until the 4th week of March. So it's not on back order. They just haven't received it yet for their, you know, so that they can ship it out to you guys.
Right.
So don't order it yet. I will say that the normal Worbla sheets, jumbo is 88. Transparent Worbla, jumbo is 96.
Yeah.
So $12 difference. You can figure about that $12 difference as you go down in size. So large sheets will be $12 difference between the two types. So there you have it. If you end up wanting to, you know, give it a try and film it, let us know. We would love to know.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because unfortunately, I don't have the money to buy one anytime soon.
I'm investing my money in something else right now, so I can't really quite play with it yet, but maybe in about a month and a half, 2 months from now, we'll see what happens. I'd be willing to give at least a small sheet a shot and see what I can come up with.
Yep, and of course, you can always go in with a couple of friends. Say if you only need a couple of gems, you know, find 3 or 4 of your friends, and you can all pitch in for it, and each just get a quarter of a jumbo sheet.
There you go.
No, that's probably the most cost-efficient way of doing it.
Yeah, Worbla. Woo!
Yes. All right.
I personally want to just go back to foam, but that's just me.
So last but not least, we wanted to thank you guys for rating and reviewing us on iTunes. We are up to 6 5-star ratings and 3 reviews now. We just got a new review. Yay, thank you. We're very appreciative of such things. Really, we are. I went and looked at the iTunes store last night for podcasts, and we are number 4 in cosplay podcasts. There are 3 guys ahead of us. None of them are actually recently updated. We're actually the most recently updated of the cosplay podcasts. But we're number 4. We haven't quite cracked the top 200 yet in our 2 categories. We are listed in arts and games and hobbies. That would be really cool if we could crack the top 200, because that would give us some major exposure in iTunes. So please, please, please keep rating us, keep reviewing us. You know, let us know if there are things to improve. We're always happy to hear your suggestions. But if you enjoy the show, please do consider doing this for us. It's one of the biggest things that you guys can do for us, because it helps give us that extra exposure and more people see us.
Exactly.
You can always spread the link to the show around. If you find a podcast aggregator that we are not listed on, for example, within the last month, we just appeared on podbay.fm. We were not there before. You guys are always welcome to submit our show on those podcast aggregators. You know, spread the word of CosPod.
We are our own religion now. I'll hail the CosPod.
And we are led by the Reverend Schmoll.
Yay! It happened.
Oh, that was awesome.
Yes, it was.
Anyways, unless you have anything else, I believe we will wrap this up.
We will wrap this up, and so that way people can get to Bill's interview that much faster.
Indeed. As always, you guys can find us on all of our social media, which you can see spread around the screen here. If you would like to contact us directly, please email us. Our address is podcast@cospod.org. That is the same address you should email if you are interested in having us as a convention guest at your next convention. Details can be found on our homepage. We do list a few of the advantages that we do happen to offer as cosplay guests.
Such as hosting your cosplay contest.
And, of course, if you guys ever have any questions, comments, concerns, suggestions, compliments, You can always contact us, talk to us in person at the show. We don't generally bite. Generally. But otherwise, we really enjoy, you know, talking with you guys, not just talking shop, but just saying, hey, how's it going? We love the show. We're really flattered when people come up to us and say they listen to the show. I will never get used to being an internet personality.
Ever. Right?
But we really genuinely appreciate you guys listening to the show and sticking with us after 4 years.
Woot!
And we will see you guys next episode in episode 86 of CosPod, the podcast for all things cosplay. Bye, guys.
Bye.
Hey Potters, we have another extra special interview for you guys. This episode, we are here with Bill Doran of Punished Props, and we are thrilled to have him on the show. Welcome, Bill.
Yay!
Hey guys, how you doing today?
We're freezing.
We're freezing over.
It's snowing outside in Texas. This is a very unusual event for us. It's like legit snow, too. It's not sleet, it's powder snow.
That's crazy, because I'm in Seattle, and my wife is actually outside mowing the lawn. It's so nice out.
No. This is like, hi, my dogs are only out for 5 seconds to use the bathroom and run back in because it's too freaking cold. Yeah. It's bad. It's bad. Wow.
So wait, all right, but this is like,
there we go.
Like Texas, how cold is Texas cold? Like, how many degrees in Fahrenheit is Texas cold?
Right now, I think we're at 32. We were at 28 yesterday.
That's legitimately cold.
Yeah. It's like cold for us is maybe about mid-50s, so this is ridiculously cold. And I'm from Chicago.
If the camera doesn't reach her, I'd show you outside my window. It looks like a winter wonderland outside.
It's really nice for photos.
All right, so first and foremost, welcome to you. You are known as the Foamsmith in the cosplay community, and you have come out with a new series called Foamsmithing.
Mm-hmm, that's right. Very
cool. First, I wanted to congratulate you. I understand that you are working on print copies now.
Oh, yeah. We are diving into the realm of real physical products, which is
nice.
Really exciting and really cool to be able, like, we got the print version of it. I wrote a trilogy of 3 ebooks for the Foamsmith trilogy. We combined them, and when I say we, I mean my wife did it because she works really hard and she's awesome. And to combine it into a single tome, it's something like almost 200 pages, big old book thing, and we got a proof from the printer, and I'm like, wow, it's a real thing. It's amazing. Because when you work on the internet, so you send this stuff out into the ether via electrons, and you don't really get a sense that you're really making something, but when you have it in your hands. The Foamsmith series is now going to be a print book. People seem to be very excited about that. We'll be doing pre-orders on punishedprops.com very soon. Possibly on Monday.
Awesome.
Yeah,
very
so
cool.
Keep your ear to the ground.
So definitely keep your eyes on that. What is the process like of writing books?
Well, all right, I'll let you in a little bit behind the scenes when I first got started into doing it. Because I don't have any training as a writer. I have done lots of writing, though. I guess that's right training as a writer. is I wrote lots and lots of blog entries for all the build write-ups for everything I make. I build props for a living and costumes for myself and all that. So I got a lot of experience doing that. And then I wanted to write, like, the single prop maker's tome, like an ebook, and spend, like, a year developing it, make this really amazing thing. And I went to a friend of mine who's done that. He's a magician, and he wrote a book about magicking stuff. Said, hey, buddy. My buddy Brian, I want to write this book. It's going to be amazing and comprehensive. And he was like, well, let's stop you right there. So you are not an author, and no one cares. No one will care if you write this book. He said, instead, write a book really fast, publish it yourself, and just get it out there. Just get familiar with the process, get a product finished, get it out there. So I did that with my first ebook. I sat down. I went through all my old blog entries, and I pulled all the best information out and wrote what I called the Beginner's Guide to Prop Making. And I put it out there, and people liked it. I sold it for like $5 as an ebook on my website, and people enjoyed it. So I wrote more and more, and I just kept iterating, kept getting better at the writing process, making it look a lot better, because that first one looked terrible. I wrote it in Google Docs. And that's basically how it was. I just kept building on the last project, getting better at it, spending more time on it, taking better photographs for my book, until we now finally have, like 2.5 years later, a product that I would consider good enough to put on paper. There you go. That's all it takes, everyone. If you want to become a writer, it just takes 2 to 3 years. Just start now.
And for those who would like to purchase the book and take pre-orders, it is, of course, all available on punishprops.com.
That's correct.
There's a lovely store down there. You guys should definitely visit it. Again, the ebooks are very affordable, you know, price of maybe a cup of coffee at Starbucks.
Or one of these micro-brewed, cold-brewed coffees I have. Like, seriously, this almost costs as much as one of my $5 ebooks.
Indeed. And the books go farther.
It's pretty good. Like, the coffee's okay. But
the book's better.
Better investment, I would say.
There you go.
Fair enough. Now, of course, we do encourage people to get the book. What would you like people to take away from reading your book?
A lot of, most of the questions I get from people, they say, like, oh, I really want to get into cosplay. I've never done it before. Where do I start? And they have this expectation, because when you look on the internet, you see these finished products, or you go to a convention, you see, like, Bumblebee, it's a crazy giant armor thing, and you think, oh, there's no way I could do that. That's a lot of work. I don't know where to start. So I wrote the ebook guides as a way to lower the barrier to entry. Say, guys, it's not that hard. Don't start with a Bumblebee costume. That's crazy. Start with something you love, but something that is more realistic. But by lowering that barrier to entry, you say, here, guys, here's some cheap materials. Here's some cheap tools, some easy techniques, things that get you started, so that you can start building that skill set and start working your way towards some of those bigger, more elaborate costumes. So that was originally my goal with the whole ebook series, and people seem to be running with it, which is great.
Awesome. And, of course, you can also find videos on these things on your website as well. I understand you have a YouTube channel.
I do have a YouTube channel. That's been a lot of fun. I have a pretty strong background in shooting video and editing from back in the day. I used to do that a lot in high school. I got to find it someday. When I was like 8, we made a Ninja Turtle fan film with my mom and her VHS camera. I got to find that.
Nice. I approve.
It's pretty awesome. We didn't have a bad guy, so instead we drew a picture of Shredder on a piece of paper and, like, taped it to the wall.
Perfect.
So I have a, you know, pretty strong background in video. But I started shooting lots of more, you know, tutorial-type stuff on my YouTube channel. Again, you look up Punish Props on YouTube, you'll find it. And again, a lot of that is your techniques and stuff that lower the barrier to entry, that get people trying how to make stuff. I do live stuff too, similar to your show that we're doing right now. I do a live show called Prop Live every week, where I have guests on and we tackle questions from the internet, from people who are looking to learn or have specific questions about something they're working on. We just had my friend Svetlana and her husband Benny from Kamui Cosplay on the show this week. That was really, really fun. And we had lots of really great questions. So all of those videos get stuck on the YouTube channel for people to watch forever, apparently. Fantastic. Show the kids.
Speaking of your show, I believe that you also have a Patreon that's ongoing to support it.
I do. That's been really cool. It's really one of the things I love about how the internet is working nowadays is I can go to the people who are benefiting the most or who appreciate the content I'm making the most and just ask them, hey, if you like the content enough and you want to just throw money at it, here's a way to do that, which has been fantastic because, believe it or not, the little bit of money I bring in from Patreon is more than I would make from normal ad revenue every month. So I like this trend going forward instead of being like, oh, I hope I get a lot of views this much so I can feed my fat cats. Instead, I can go to the people who are consuming the content I make, and they can be like, oh, that content's awesome. Here's a dollar. All right. Yay,
and
Patreon.
Do you have an address where people can find this Patreon?
Oh, yes, that's right. Patreon.com/punishedprompts.
There we go. Because we don't do this with Cosplay Boom enough. I mean, heck.
All right. So, you are obviously a big fan of foam. For those who are just wanting to get into armoring and prop making with foam, can you talk a little bit about the advantages and disadvantages of using different types of foam?
Please.
Certainly. Actually, I learned something today. I'll tell you about this, and then I'll get into the my foam spiel. I just started using L200, which is a type of EVA foam, kind of like the floor mats that I really like to use. There's a technique that I like a lot where you take a floor mat and you score it with a sharp knife, and then you hit that with a heat gun, and it separates. It makes a kind of a nice recess. So I did the same thing on a piece of L200 that I was using for the armor that I'm working on right now. And I'm not familiar with L200. I only just started working on it. Well, the L200 does not separate that way. It kind of melts a little bit. Excuse me. So I was like, and this was on my live stream yesterday, just curse words as I'm like, as you guys can all see, as I hit this with the heat gun, the line will separate, leaving a beautiful, gorgeous seam where I... Oh god! Oh, it's not working. Oh my god, you guys, it's melting. No. So I learned a little bit. There's a little bit of difference between those two materials. But in general, when I talk about foam for armor making, I'm talking about EVA foam, ethyl vinyl acetate, I think. Anyway, foam floor mats, craft foam, or fun foam, the stuff you can get from your Joann's or Michael's or any craft store. I'm the guy that goes in there, and there's the quarter inch stuff or the 6mm stuff, and they have this stack of black and white, and I walk in and I go, sorry kids, these are mine, and I buy all of it. You can get it even thinner too in big rolls like the 2mm stuff, which I buy a roll of that, and the floor mats and all kinds of really cool ways you can get your EVA foam. It's flexible, it's squishy, it's cheap, it's easy to cut. It's easy to glue, so when it comes to making armor, it's a great medium because you can work fast, you can screw up, you can throw it away, you can try again, and it doesn't cost you a whole arm and a leg. It will take a lot of time to get good at the techniques, but we got time, right? You can learn, and the more time you put into it, the better you'll get at it, and it'll start looking really, really awesome. It's lightweight. It doesn't breathe when you're wearing it, so you get kind of sweaty underneath your armor there. But, I mean, we're all going to be stinky cosplayers at the end of the day. Anyway, so a lot of advantages, not too many disadvantages. You can't really fill it, like if you gouge a part out. Like yesterday I was cutting part of mine, and it just barely fit in my scroll saw, so I kind of wedged it in there to finish the cut, and it gouged part of it. I can't, like... fill it in with Bondo and sand it smooth. That won't really work with the foam. But I'm like, hey, that part's going to be battle damage later on. I'll put like a bullet hole in there. It'll be awesome. So a couple downsides, but overall the upsides are well worth it, especially if you're trying to make something really fast. So hooray, foam!
I am a proponent of all things craft foam. Amber doesn't like me very much because of that.
Is Amber a Worbla enthusiast?
Actually, no, I have, in fact, I'm working on some of it right now. I've become a proponent of craft foam and styrene on top of each other.
Okay,
so I do a little of both worlds, the hard and the soft.
And the soft, yeah.
So is that like super thin styrene?
Yeah.
Yeah, I got some of that.
It's 0.02.
Yeah, I really, really think
so. It's half the stuff of the stormtroopers that you use. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep. That's cool. So what's the advantage of sticking them together then? Does the foam make it like a little bit more durable or still being staying
lightweight? The foam gives it a little bit more of a structure because styrene on its own doesn't have much of one, especially at that thickness or lack thereof. And I like the styrene on top because it gives me a good smooth area that absorbs paint really well.
Yeah, because the foam can be a little porous and it'll soak up your paint a little bit.
Yeah, I made friends with gesso.
Right, yeah, so you don't really have to worry too much about sealing that because you have the styrene on the outside.
Right.
Pretty nice. Do you just cut the styrene just with a sharp knife then?
Mm-hmm.
Very nice. I figure.
Yeah, I use manicure scissors for the intricate stuff, but otherwise just a really nice sharp X-Acto blade.
Yeah, there you go. I'll tell you what I got. I got a machine hiding over there. It's pretty sweet. I have a laser cutter.
Oh yeah, that's fancy.
So when I see that intricate cuts you have in there, all I can think is like, boy, I could cut like 10 of those out right now. Like the foam and styrene work really, really great in the laser.
I'm so jealous.
So I would even that'd be kind of tricky to do. I was thinking I could laminate those two materials together and then cut it out. But different materials in the laser burn and melt at different amounts. So it may cut through the styrene and then obliterate the foam underneath.
Plus, it would probably smell absolutely lovely to have burning foam.
You know what? All right. Burning foam is pretty bad. I have a really good exhaust fan for that thing. But the worst so far has been leather.
Burning leather is horrid. It is terrible. I thought worbla smelled bad.
Yeah. We did a piece for my friend. She did some leather bracers, and we did some engraving on there with the laser. It looked incredible, but it smelled like burning butthole in there. It was really
That's pretty accurate, actually.
Yeah.
Fair enough. Well, I did have an opportunity, and if anybody else would like to see your portfolio, you can find it at punishedprops.com/portfolio. There's some amazing pieces in there.
Thank you.
They don't look like foam at all.
Well, a lot of the stuff that I've done are more rigid materials. I will tell you though, what's in my portfolio? Let's look at that. A lot of the stuff I have, like the
a lot of shooty things.
Yeah, a lot of guns, man. I like guns. Which is funny. I'm not actually. I don't own any real guns. I'm not like a gun nut. A lot of the material, the props I have in there are like hard surface stuff. A lot of them I'll mold and cast in a urethane resin, so it's a rigid piece. But the Destiny hand cannon I have in there is... Oh, I don't have it in my portfolio. But I made a Destiny hand cannon, and if you look up Destiny hand cannon video on YouTube, you'll probably find the video on how I built it. And that was all done out of EVA foam. And I've done tons and tons of like molded and cast props, but if I'm going to carry something around at a convention, especially if it's big, I want to make it out of foam, because it's so much lighter. My buddy Harrison Cricks over at Vulpen Props built this giant hammer, and it's like 4.5 pounds, which is ridiculous because that thing should weigh like 40 pounds. But if you have to carry it around at a convention all day, oh man, that foam is so good. So good.
So with those projects, how do you pick and choose which projects you're going to take on?
I do. Most of the stuff I have so far have been commissions. People have paid me to like, hey, Bill, I want a Halo sniper rifle. And I'm like, all right, it's going to cost this much. And they're like, okay. So I go in and make it for them. And that's why there's a Halo sniper rifle in my portfolio. So most of the stuff I do, I don't really get to pick. I do have, like, on my Facebook page, I have an album there. I'm like, hey, here's some stuff I'd really like to make, you guys. And if... And so far, no one's really bit at those, but I'm like, hey, I really want to make, let me look at this real quick. Photos, albums. What have I put in there? It's called Bill's Big List of Things He Would Really Like You to Pay Him to Make. That's what the album's called. So I've got, like, some guns from Borderlands. I love revolvers, like big chunky-looking revolvers. So the revolver from... let's see, what's this one? Deus Ex Human Revolution. Oh, this big... Have you guys played Orcs Must Die? You
play that game? Yes. Oh, goodness.
Yeah, some of the guns are the big blade staff thingy. As it, no one's commissioned me yet to build anything from that album, but it would be awesome if they did. So,
well, here's where we can leverage our audience here, since we do a fairly large audience. Potters, should you wish to have some professional-grade props made, go look at this album. It's really cool.
It's the cool stuff. Right now, I really want to make... I'm making a Destiny costume for myself. I really want to make a gun from Destiny. Actually, I want to make, like, 10 guns from Destiny. So I will be at least making one of them for myself. So the trick is... because I do this for a living, how do I spend a lot of time building something for myself how do I make money doing that? Because I can't finish a product and be like, all right, can you guys just pay me for me to keep this? So that's the real challenge. So one of the reasons why I do so much instructional content is so that I can sort of show people how I make stuff and then sell that content, and then I can make whatever I want. And then maybe keep it. Because most of the stuff I have in my portfolio is gone. I built it and it goes out the door and I don't have it anymore.
It's nice to have a prop wall of all of your achievements. I'm actually looking at the Borderlands gun and I'm like, you know what? Angel could probably use a weapon. Maybe I should commission that.
Is that the plasma caster I did?
Yes.
Yeah, that's a great example. Like, I built that for a guy for Dragon Con. I sold it to him. He paid a good amount for it, and he loved it, and it's gone now. And I I like it a lot. I kind of wish I still had that.
Life of a commissioner.
Exactly.
So, just as an armorer and prop maker myself, I've always enjoyed picking the brains of fellow armorers and prop makers. Whenever you have a new project that you want to start on, what's kind of the thought process you go through when, you know, starting to put together how you're going to do it?
That's a great question. Actually, yesterday I did a live stream from my shop for like 5.5 hours where I was starting on the chest piece for my Titan armor. And if you go to Punished Props YouTube channel, you'll see it there. So if you got 5 hours and you really want to dive in and see how my brain works, because a lot of that 5 hours was me talking to myself, feeling, but you can kind of see my thought process for when I'm taking a design from scratch and sort of building it out. But in general, for something like a prop, like a hand, like a gun, let's say, I go out and I collect a ton of reference images, more than I think I need. So, like, from Destiny, or for my Destiny armor, I loaded up my character and my wife's character on separate consoles, and I had my wife's character, like, hovering around me, like, taking tons of screenshots, mostly of the butt, lots of butt screenshots, all around my character, and then I grabbed those screenshots. Actually, on the PS4, it's really cool. There's, like, a share button, so you can just do snapshots.
Which is so much easier for getting reference photos. Oh, my goodness.
Yes. It's really awesome. So I did do that, or I'll search online, do like a Google image search, look for the highest resolution images you can find. Or if it's possible, if you can rip the game files out of something, even better. And then I start the design process. A lot of times that means drawing a blueprint for my prop. And what I'll do is I'll take multiple views of a prop, and I'll start drawing it out. And it's kind of like the first time building it, because as you're drawing out this design, you're piecing it together in your head, trying to figure out, you know, oh, that part's going to be kind of tricky, or how am I going to layer these pieces? And then once I have my blueprint all drawn out, then I'll print it out full scale and start building it. And then you kind of go through that second build process where a lot of the ideas that worked in your head on paper get thrown right out because they totally won't work when you're working in three-dimensional space. But it's this process that just evolves as you build through your prop. But definitely, lots of reference images. Put a lot of design work into something before you start cutting into your material.
Measure twice, cut once.
Mm-hmm. Or as my wife says, measure twice and try not to cut yourself.
That's the prop maker's creed,
like
right
it.
There.
That's right. I want to put. She's. I think we're designing shirts already. We're gonna put that on the shirts.
That or bumper stickers.
Yep.
All right. So we had a couple of questions come in from our listeners for you, and the first question that they wanted to ask you is, what kind of starter kit do you recommend for those who are just starting?
The tools that I recommend, and in fact, if you go to punishprops.com, oh boy, I am ready. Where did my mouse cursor go? There it is. I have, if you go to the shop section, there is a Bill's tools list with links to all the kinds of tools that I like to use. Yep, there it is. Shop Bill's tools.
That's cool. And very smart.
People ask me enough, so I'm like, hey, guys, there's a list right there.
Right.
And all of these links will send you to Amazon if people want to buy some of these tools. And also, if you use those links, then I get a cut, which is awesome. Thank you, Amazon. Anyway, there's a bunch of really great stuff in there. So, like safety, like a respirator or cartridges for your respirator, there's a link on there. So, be safe, everybody. The kind of hand tools that I really recommend if you're getting started, X-Acto knife you guys mentioned, obviously. Lots of replacement blades because as soon as a blade gets dull, just throw it away. Get like 100 pack of replacement blades. They're awesome. I like rotary tools, so your Dremel tool. I have a Craftsman one with like a flexible shaft and about a million different bits for it. If you're going to spend money somewhere, I would say that's a good place to spend it. Get a good like Dremel one or a Craftsman one. And there are so many really awesome, cool things you can do. You can cut with those. You can sculpt with those. You can do really cool things. So get a rotary tool. That's a wonderful place to start. What else is on here? All kinds of things. Little files. If you're doing really detail work, little files. And in fact, what'd you call them? Nail files? Nail files are really handy too for doing fine sanding. And then if you're doing a lot of hard surface like prop making with like woods and plastics and stuff, you're going to do a lot of sanding. Lots of sanding. So invest in some good quality sandpaper. Whenever I'm shopping for that sort of stuff, I go to Amazon and I just read reviews and see what people really like. And then some power tools. Do you guys have any favorite power tools that you really like?
Scroll saw.
Yes. Well, I mean, the scroll saw is great, and I love it. It's been my workhorse for a long time. But ever since I got that laser cutter, the scroll saw gets a lot less action.
It's useful for cutting EvaFoam if you need just really basic cuts quick.
Yeah, it really is. And in fact, I had a really big bevel to put on my EVA foam armor, and I did it in my scroll saw. And I have a bandsaw too, but the way it was angled, I actually couldn't fit the armor through the bandsaw. So obviously, I need a bigger bandsaw, right? Obviously. But it worked out pretty well in the scroll saw. I use my scroll saw for a very long time, another Craftsman tool. In fact, when I got married, my wife and I registered at Sears, which was perfect because they have like dishes and plates and that stuff that you need, I guess. But they also sell tools. So there's a pro tip, folks. If you're getting married, register at Sears and get all your Craftsman tools there. So yeah, that scroll saw is another fantastic one. And then let's give you one more good tool to get started here. Let's see what's another good one. Rulers. How about some really good rulers? I like the see-through rulers with like a grid on it for doing like parallel lines. Those are really neat too. There you go. That'll get you started.
Okay.
I said those definitely come in handy.
Mm-hmm.
Not just for prop making.
Mm-mm. Just about everything.
Mm-hmm. And actually, on a related note, the next question we have in from our listeners is, what is your favorite kind of paint and or brush?
Well, I mean, it depends on what you're working on, obviously. I mean,
how about let's just say you're making a foam gun, because that seems to be the theme we're going with.
Yeah,
here.
That's a good one. I like using acrylic paints for foam because they can be flexible. Although, if I'm just going to take something and paint it really fast without sealing it or anything, I'll go get Krylon Fusion paint, just the spray paint. Or even just if you want to just put a base color down on your armor or on your... excuse me, on like a foam gun. Krylon Fusion is awesome. It dries really fast. A lot of spray paints will say, dries, like fast drying, blur. It's a lie. Like read the back of the can, see what it really says. It'll be like, dries in 10 minutes. Lies. Krylon Fusion actually dries really fast. And it, I think it has acetone in it, so it like eats into the plastic surface that you're putting it on, so it bonds really well to foam. So I like Krylon Fusion a lot. And then for detail work, I usually use acrylics for foam. But I also have lots of enamel paints. I also have lots of lacquer paints. I also have, tons and tons of different kinds of acrylics, tons of different mystery spray paints. Like, it looks cool. I have no idea what it is. What else do I have? There's a paint is just a crazy, crazy world that you can get into. I really want to get into catalyzed automotive paints.
Those are fancy. Yeah.
We'll see. I haven't dipped my toe into that world yet. What was that?
Do you airbrush?
Yeah, I do. You know what? I don't do a lot of like airbrushing for the sake of like getting that airbrushed look, but I use it as a way to apply different paints. Usually like some of the lacquers I use apply really well if you put it through an airbrush. So I do. I have a couple airbrushes. That's another world. Like, you start dipping your toe into the airbrush world, and you're like, this airbrush is pretty cool, but what if I buy that one? And you get, and then you have two of them, you're like, these are both pretty good, but what if I buy those three? And then you're like, why do I have 10 airbrushes?
Because you can. And they all do different things.
Yeah, they do. Yep. And because I'm an adult, and no one is there to tell me no.
Exactly.
All right, and then the final question we had in from our listeners is, do you have any advice for aspiring prop makers, beginner or advanced?
Yeah, I'll tell you what. If you ever, this is what I did, and this is not, whether it's professional or not, when I decided to do this for a living, I told myself, I had one rule, because I had a pretty good job. I used to work at Microsoft. They're doing okay. It was a pretty good job, and I quit that to do this for a living. And I told myself that if I found myself doing work that I didn't really enjoy doing just to get a paycheck, then what's the point, right? Go back to Microsoft. If you're building something, if you're getting into prop making and you find and you hate it and like the process sucks and you're just not enjoying it, then stop. If you don't like working with EVA foam, stop. Try worbla. If you don't like a particular tool, try a different one. If you're not enjoying the process, it's really, no matter how much you love like that, like Destiny, let's say, I love Destiny and I really want to make this particular gun. A, start building stuff that you really like, because sometimes when you get frustrated, that obsession is the only thing that's going to get you to the finish line. But if you do absolutely hate it, then stop. Try something else. especially if you're gonna try and go down, yeah, pay someone else for sure. I hate sewing. I pay other people to do sewing. That's what I do. If you're gonna try and go down the professional route, then if there's part of it you don't enjoy doing, you have to love it to make it work, you know, full time.
Words to live by.
Yeah, for a good example, I tried to be a professional photographer. That was a hobby of mine, shooting photography. So I went and I was like, I'm going to shoot some weddings. And like three weddings later, I was like, I'm done with this crap.
That sounds like me. Yeah. Shooting weddings sucks.
Mm-hmm. I like doing it as a hobby. I like taking pictures of animals. That's kind of fun. Animals don't pay you to shoot them, though, so...
Yeah, that's kind of the downside. It's like, yeah. Unless the zoo is paying you, it's like, no.
Yeah. So I kept that as a hobby, and it's a lot, for me, that's a lot more fun as a casual hobby sort of thing. Mm-hmm. It's gotta stay fun, you guys. Gotta stay fun.
Exactly.
Which also, there is a tutorial video on his website on how to take awesome photos of your cosplay.
Yes. Yeah, I made it because I get really disappointed when I see someone put like hours and hours and hours of work into a project. It's amazing, and I know it's amazing, but they put it in like the corner of their closet and then take a picture with their cell phone in the dark, and I'm like, oh, no one can see how awesome it is. Take better photos.
I'm guilty of that, mm-hmm. And I'm knowingly guilty of it.
Yeah.
Alrighty. Belle, do you have any other questions?
I do, actually. Do you plan to make a return of the Claptrap Puppet Army to Dragon Con?
I'm not sure where that's going to go. That was really fun. I gave my Claptrap away. A friend of mine in Atlanta, when we were at Dragon Con, he's like, oh, Claptrap's pretty cool. And I was like, well, I don't want to drag that stupid thing home. So how about it's yours? It's yours, man. So I don't have mine anymore. If I have time, I would like to rebuild it. We'll see. My twin brother and I, we did Dr. Zed and Dr. Ned costumes, which is a perfect twin costume. We'll see. That may or may not make a return to Dragon Con. I'm not sure, but it was a lot of fun to do. We do actually have a Facebook page. If you look up, if you go to Facebook and look up Clap Trap Puppet Builders Club, we are 125 members strong. Yeah.
Yay! Nice.
And that's kind of the place where people go to talk about building claptraps, I guess. For example, this guy built one that's got electronics in it, which is really cool. Let's see what else here. Anyway, yeah, if you're interested in Claptrap, just go to Facebook and look up the Claptrap Puppet Builders Club. And we'll see if we can arrange something for the next Dragon Con.
The hope is we wanted to bring one this past year, but it's just lack of storage space and lack of suitcase space that prevented us from doing it. So we're going to try to make it happen.
Yeah, and that was the challenge. So if folks go to YouTube and look up the Claptrap Puppet build that I did, I designed it to be able to come apart and lay flat in a suitcase. So it's not the most perfectly detailed Claptrap, but it is the most suitcase-worthy Claptrap.
And when you're a costumer and cosplayer, that's really helpful.
it really, really, especially if you have to bring that and like your Draugr armor with you, because of course you're gonna bring your Draugr armor with you.
Of course.
Yeah, you gotta accommodate for your Claptrap puppet and your Skyrim armor.
Absolutely. In my case, it'd be all my Star Wars crap and my lightsabers. So
yeah.
There you go.
Oh, geez. And I don't know how this happened, but I don't even have a lightsaber yet. I feel like
we gotta
that's
fix that.
Yeah, I know. I feel like that's going to be similar to the airbrush thing. I'm going to buy one lightsaber, and then a month later, I'm going to be like, guys, I have so many lightsabers now.
I have 5, and I plan to get another one within the next week. So yeah, yep. You just start getting addicted to it.
Once I buy a metal lathe and like a vertical mill, like all bets are off. I'm just hey guys, I bought a lightsaber making tool.
And you just invite all of your friends over and stage giant battles on film.
Yeah, I gotta do that.
Oh, we've inspired another army.
Well, with the new movie coming out, like I should make that a personal goal. I need to have like a Star Wars costume and a lightsaber by the time the new movie comes out. It's a good personal goal.
There you go. You got a couple of months. You got it.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, we would like to thank you once again for giving us your time today. It was a wonderful time. Thank you so much for being with us.
Well, thank you guys for having me. I've been having a blast.
This is great.
I'm still jealous of the laser cutter.
I know, right? I'm like, maybe I could actually do props that way. Because I suck doing them everywhere else. I want a laser cutter.
It's pretty handy. You know what? If you don't have your own laser cutter, which, I mean, you should, but if, you know, they're a little pricey. Pinoco.com does laser cutting, and before I got mine, that's where I would go. Just send them a vector file, and they'll cut it out and send you laser cut parts. It's pretty awesome. Especially if you need a lot of something. Like, you know what I cut out with that thing? Most circles. I've cut out dozens of circles with that thing. Because it makes a perfect circle every time. And I'm like, oh, I need 20 circles. And just go.
Circles suck to cut out, so if you have something to do it for you, it's even better.
Oh, yeah.
Alrighty. Well, Potters, we hope you enjoyed.
Hooray!
Yay!